And Kat will be telling us all about trash art and how to incorporate trash into your own art. So Kat, take it away.
Okay, hi. Oh, wow, okay. I was not expecting that loud. All right, but hi. So I have structured the talk for today pretty much on ye gods, you're making art out of wood. But the idea is a combination of we're going to start out with why I started doing this, and then we will go through the general groupings of materials I work with, because everybody's going to do their own thing when you're making your stuff, so it's not really helpful to find out how I do it in terms of like structure. It's helpful to be like, okay, what the heck do you do with this bottle cap? Okay, so first off, reason being, wow, what the heck, art supplies are expensive. The reason being is I used to work at an art store, and when you have had to sell Arches watercolor paper to a college student, you kind of realize that a lot of people are very worried about messing up their work because the cost of the supplies has just increased. Part of it is because it's trying to be pH neutral or be really great for preservation or get a particular effect, which, you know, I'm used to. This is actually what my work usually looks like. I'm usually using pen and ink with digital, or I'm doing gouache, and I love it. But I was pretty aware of the fact that if I messed up that sheet of paper, I was going to be out like $1.50. So, okay, trash. Nice thing about it. If I mess it up, it's already messed up. I mean, who cares? Ooh, my mic is starting to slide. Stay right there, will ya? Okay, there we go. So if, let's say, I was working on this piece and, okay, the effect didn't really work, it kind of glued on, it's literally a shelf. Who's going to care? Okay, next slide. Yeah, climate change is heckin' terrifying. So this is pretty much me at 3 a.m. before I started integrating waste into my workflow. Yeah, we've all been there. We've all been there. So that was sort of the thing, is unfortunately, we are dealing with the fact that the sheer amount of waste being made, there's not really much you can do on an individual level. But the problem is on an individual level is how you keep yourself sane enough to deal with it. So for me, it was about figuring out, all right, well, my inks, my, you know, costuming, everything else, it's creating a certain amount of waste. What can I do with that? And also combined with the fact that I very much like saving money, it turned into, all right, well, let's see about collaging on boards. Okay, this is really fun. This means I can use the small little bits of yarn that I had left over from a project, pop it on in there, and also just, you know, throw together these robots, which, honest to goodness, I did not expect this to become a thing. These guys just sort of happened. Started out with this one because I was looking for a way to do sculpture work, but I wanted to do something a little cheaper. All right, so yeah, what you need to get started. A lot of the time, again, kind of low barriers of entry. One, you're going to need some kind of glue. One thing I will recommend, different glues are going to stick different things. Super glue with an accelerant is actually amazing for plastic. But if you tried to, let's say, use like super glue on a wooden board, it doesn't actually like to be worked with. So double check what things you're trying to stick to what, because also hot glue is fast. Unfortunately, that means the bond is not great. So especially if something's going to be load bearing, hot glue, not your friend. But hot glue is honestly amazing if you're going to be needing to put like tiny little beads on things. It's great. Then you'll need paintbrushes. You can also use really cruddy paintbrushes for a lot of stuff. I do also recommend have at least one cruddy one for your glue, because you're going to dip it in. You can move it around. You can then add like glitter or other materials. It's just nice to have at least one crap brush. Other one is an X-Acto or box cutter. I actually like using big old box cutters instead of thinner X-Actos, partially because they're bigger for my hand. I have tendonitis, so I can kind of use it with it. It's a bit larger. And also, it means you can use it for a lot of your materials. You can use it for paper, you can use it for cardboard, you can use it for, like, heck, plastic. Just always, always cut away from yourself. Don't do this. Your legs here, you need those. Same with the cutting surface. I found if you just stack up cardboard, you're usually set. You can get like specific self-healing cutting mats. They are amazing, but see if you actually like doing X-Acto work before you're gonna like spend $20 on a mat. Like, don't do that. Yep, same thing with rags. One thing is I actually mostly use cloth rags because when I'm done with them, I can soak them in glue and then use them as a texture item. Paper towels, once they're completely dead, I can do that, but it just feels kind of silly. If I've already got rags that I can just clean until they're completely weird and then I can just use them in my work, like, why? So I usually only keep those for stuff that I know is going to have to be thrown out at some point. Like, I don't do a lot of oil, but like linseed oil is one of those materials that I'd be like, hell, if I leave you in a stack, you could catch fire. No, we're gonna go paper towels for those. The other thing is that some kind of plan. You don't have to have a lot of a plan. You can honestly just look at your piece and go, you know, I just wanted circles today. And then you just kind of run with it. Like, with that one right there, I actually kind of went with thinking, oh, I just kind of want to play with squiggles across it. I sketched down another piece of paper to see if I kind of liked the shapes, and then I went, all right. And it doesn't look anything like the plan I made, but it gave me an idea of kind of what I was trying to go for. You can totally go in without a plan, but it's sometimes just nice, even like a quick sketch, to be like, all right, I think I know what I'm doing. Again, a sense that sharp things should point away from you. I do not want to hear of anybody stabbing themselves in the leg because they thought, hey, I can just cut towards me. Don't do that. Don't do it. I do it myself. It's stupid. I don't think I should. Don't be me. Don't do this. And then, yes, glorious garbage. The great thing about this is that once you start collecting this kind of thing, you realize there is so much potential in everything that's around us. It's really fun. Okay, so first, we're going to start off with the easy one. So we're going to go with magazines, paper waste, working surfaces. So we'll use these as an example. This one here is actually on a piece of shelf that I found somebody was throwing out for bulk trash. So I commandeered it in the name of me and took it home. These are actually all of the old price tags from my convention. There's also a little piece of silver paper right in through here. You'll also see, I'm just gonna cross over here, you'll also see some of those same silver papers. A lot of those come from peanut butter jars or different other materials. These specifically are from tea bags. Gonna go back over here. But yeah, the idea is that this surface was gonna get thrown out. All you had to do to prep it was I took a piece of sandpaper, gave it a bit, you know, like kind of medium grain, gave it a bit of rough. That's to make sure that the glue can bond well with the surface. Because if the glue doesn't have anything to grip on, have you ever tried to like grab a water bottle when it's really wet? Yeah, same idea. It's easier if you got a little bit of something to hold on to. And then with this one as well, this here, that's parts of it are actually teabag wrappers that I then cut into slices and layered up. That particular piece over there is also just a little piece of foil that came off of packaging. The great thing about these materials, though, for me, is that magazines are everywhere. Like, it is crazy the amount of supplies and colors and everything you can get out of magazines. Specifically, actually, the back of this particular piece is all magazine offcuts, because after I'd cut out all the eyes I wanted, or if I was like, oh, I really like this hand or this face, I'd end up with scraps. And most of the time, you just throw those in a recycling bin, but I kept looking at it and going, I gotta do better than this. I gotta do better than this. Okay. So what I did was I went, okay, what if I just use all of the warm colored pieces and I made a ground that I could then paint on? And that gave me that. So that's sort of the idea behind those kind of materials, is sometimes you can just use them as a base for working in a more traditional method. You don't have to go full on like layering all the materials, and this is like on watercolor paper, but it's popped out. You can use it as almost like a background if you're starting to like kind of dip your toes in. And again, it's a magazine. You can get those for free by just going through like the recycling bin at your workplace. So yeah, the one thing I will warn you is definitely if you ever find paper that has foil in it, grab that. Because unfortunately, paper with foil in it cannot be recycled. It's considered a mixed material, which means go nuts. If you find gilt like wrapping paper or something like that, use that. You just throw it out otherwise. So like, why not? Go for it. All right, now we get to my favorite. I am biased. We're going to bottle caps. I love bottle caps because they allow for 3D surfaces in a way that you can't usually get. With this one specifically, oops, excuse me, Beatrice. So these are actually filled with a little bit of Mod Podge that has a bit of a bevel because they're little wells. That's the great thing with bottle caps. You can pretty much just fill them up with whatever materials you want. I actually did a couple of pieces where what I did was it's kind of ridiculous. I actually filled them with beads that were really small and almost like little seed beads, and I mixed them with some clear glue and I poured them into each of the sections so it'd have a surface to then put tiny eyes on top of. So that's the thing. You have those tiny wells there. They're great. You can also punch holes in them, stack them to be able to get tubes or like almost you can get tentacles out of them. They're fairly sculptural. They are also ridiculously common. You can either just save the bottle tabs from your house. You can honestly, I got most of these from my uncle, hilariously enough, because he drinks a lot of cream soda, so he just saved me the bottle tabs. So if you don't usually have bottles in your house, someone around you is probably going to have them. And again, they can be easily reworked. The one thing to keep in mind is that some of them will have logos. You may want to make sure to have the logo not be visible, simply because if you're gonna be selling it like, you know, some kind of galleries, they'll be a little dodgy about that because it's like, well, you don't really have rights to the logo. So honestly, best thing to do, you can sandpaper it off, you can glue it with the logo popped down. It's not exactly like the cream soda company is gonna sue me now, so problem solved there. And yeah, as you can see in here, we've got the bottle cabs here, and all of those had paint poured. I can speak, I'm sorry. There we go. All of these had paint poured in them, and then the googly eyes were placed on top. So that gives you another idea of how to work with them. Now with the bits and bobs, this is more if you're dealing with just oddly shaped pieces. Trying to glue stuff like this can be a kind of a pain. So what I'll usually do with these is I'll actually sew them to the work, or you can drill into the material using a Dremel. Make sure to have mask and goggles on because you never really want to have something fly past your eye and be like, oh God, that could have been my eyeball. But yeah, so as you can see with these, these are just pieces of a car that I found on the street and just add them on. But a lot of the time these are thrown out the same time as bottle caps. So you can use those as a really fun way to sort of layer up and create texture, because the thing with magazines and the rest, they're very flat. So then once you've got that flat surface, you can then add more 3D materials on top and you can add in a bit more of that kind of layered texture. Like actually that little diamonds and stuff like that, those are part of a children's toy from one of my old jobs that was busted and was gonna get thrown out. Same thing with the bits and bobs, just those little pieces of things. See what kind of shapes you can find. Like bottle caps, always gonna be circles unless it's had some violence done to it. But yeah, that's gonna be your automatic sort of like, okay, if you want circle shapes in your piece, easy enough. Okay, here's the thing that kind of got, I think pretty much everybody knows me for at this point. Foil. Oh my God, okay. Who here drinks tea? Okay, we got two tea drinkers. Okay, we got three tea drinkers. Okay, do you go with loose leaf or do you go with foil, like foil bags? Like mix of things, pretty much? Yeah. Yeah, both's good. The reason being is the foil from those tea bags, those little ones you come over, is one of the best gosh darn things for just layering the crap out of. Especially you can see with these guys, this is all twinnings. Pretty much I just cut it out and I used a glue stick. I have found with this kind of foil, you don't actually want to use a very thick glue. Glue sticks are gonna be your friend. It's better to use those because unfortunately it'll start to curl because it's so wet. The material just starts to buckle on you. Instead though, you can just layer them up into these thin strips. You can cut them out into shapes. It's a really easy way to get a very like shiny effect for, you were literally gonna throw that packet out anyway. Also, you can use other types of foil. Like this piece in here, this is actually gum wrappers. So with this here, same sort of setup with the glue stick, just layered amounts of five gum wrappers. They came out a couple like years ago. They had all of these different colors and stuff. I had a gum chewing habit in college and I saved all of them because I was making gum wrapper chains. And then I thought, wait, this is just cheap gilding. Because here's the thing, gilding looks amazing. But if you're wanting to play around with gilding, a lot of the time you have to fork over a, let's say, high amount of money. And unless you're trying to work with a particular sort of, And unless you're trying to work on, let's say, like beautiful watercolor paper and you want your gilding to be like laid in thin little rivulets and the rest of it, you don't need to buy that kind of gilding. You can just go use tea bags, use your gum wrappers, anything with foil. I've also had really good luck with peanut butter lids, like the little safety lids and stuff. The one thing is, wash those suckers because the oil can transfer to your pieces. That's also just a general caveat with anything. If you don't know where it came from, wash it. You do not want to bring any friends home. You want to bring home inspiration, not bed bugs. So yeah, general thing. But yeah, foil is one of those, you can literally encrust it over a particular material. You can use it to add eyes. This is actually the same gum wrappers in here, same gum wrappers on him. You don't have any, but it's okay. We still love you. So that's the thing. Foil is one of those, you can just mold it. And with a lot of the stuff you're finding in packaging, it might have a paper background. And that actually makes it easier for you to glue because, you know, have you ever tried to like handle really thin foil with your sticky fingers and it just sticks to everything and it peels off and you just, yeah, the paper backing actually gives you a little bit of a heads up there. So definitely recommend, gum wrappers are great for that. Actually, one thing that I will warn you, some of the foil, if it's really plasticky, like candy bar wrappers are a good example, not the paperback ones, you can still use those. But they're so plasticky, you gotta be a little careful because they don't react to heat very well. So don't use a glue gun with them. It might melt and it will stink, so don't do that. But you can glue with them, just you might wanna use them more if you're doing, let's say, like the bottle caps and you want some foil on the bottom. You can like lightly glue it in with a glue stick and then pour the glue on top and it'll be fine. Okay, so here's where we're gonna get into these suckers. So, the main reason I got into doing the robots is because I have a lot of fabric. I have a lot of fabric because my mother's a costumer. And I have ended up with so many offcuts, like ridiculous amounts of them. So I got into doing patchwork. And you can actually see on my pants here, these are old curtains. Because it was like, hey, I need to eat. But there is a problem with fabric, mostly two. One, dry rot. Have you ever had a 100% cotton sheet that you have tried to throw on your bed and then suddenly there is a hand-shaped hole through it? That is dry rot. Basically, it means the fabric fibers have reached the point they cannot hold up anymore. If the material is 100% natural material, it's not a huge deal. You just shred it up, throw it in your compost, and you're done. Here's where the slight problem happens. Number two, the fabric cannot be recycled. Most fabrics actually have a hard time being recycled. This is partially because they're either a mixed material, such as, you know, mostly cotton, but with enough spandex to give you some stretch if you're sitting down. Problem is, that means you can't throw it in the compost because of that tiny 3% amount of spandex. Now imagine that with bras. I perennially wear sports bras, except at a certain point, these sports bras completely die. They are going to just, you know, there's nothing left of them. Except they're nearly 100% elastane or spandex. You cannot scrub with them, you can't polish with them, you can't compost them. And so being me, I just stuck them in a bag and pretended they didn't exist. Until during, you know, the major parts of lockdown, I was sort of forced to look at my studio and go, you know, maybe I should clean in here. And I came across an absolute pile of that material. It was stuff with dry rot that had just enough spandex in it, I couldn't send it out. It was old bras, it was old workout wear. And I looked at it and I'm like, what am I gonna do with this? Now, a reasonable person would have looked at this and gone, you know, there's nothing I can do with this at this point. You know, it's gotta go, et cetera. I was like, no, I have kept this for this long. I'm gonna figure out what to do with it. And I also had a ton of wire hangers. So that's how I started out with this guy. So as you can see, that is an old shirt. You've got a general shape that's just old dry rotted fabric that's been wrapped around the actual structure. The great thing about this is it means that I didn't really have to do a lot with clay. This one I purposely did. There's actually some clay on the legs here and on the face. But the actual body is all, you can kind of see it here, there's some stitching and the rest of it. That is all just dry rotted fabric that I wrapped. So the great thing about it is it meant that one, that stretchy material that I was gonna throw out suddenly became a godsend because stretchy material wraps really, really well. I could yank it into position. And you can kind of see that actually with the buildup. Excuse me, Beatrice, apologies. So you can actually see parts of the original spandex right underneath here. So I build up the form, then slide over all of the little leglets into place. because these could be sewed separately as little covers and just pulled on, because these are actually old dance fabric from my mom's work. You can definitely use other materials to cover with, like Meriwether here. They're actually entirely covered in cotton, but as you can see, I had to basically piece it into place and then sew it is the main issue, because the fabric isn't naturally stretchy. But the nice thing is this means also you don't just have to go with fabric under your underform. You can actually use a bunch of other materials. So, okay, just gonna make a guess here. You can see Meriwether has some very, very thick thighs. You're very juicy, it's okay. We still love you. Thing is, you can see there's like a little bit of a rim right here. Do I have any guesses what their thighs are made out of? Close, but no.
Pill bottle.
Okay, that's actually true for Beatrice's butt. So you're not wrong.
Also, as a time reminder, we are currently at the 20-minute mark.
Oh,
we
excellent.
We have about 20, 22 minutes or so left.
Ooh, okay. I'm nearly done with the slides. I go real fast. Jeez. Well, that's okay. What's up? So pill bottle, no, because pill bottles are usually a bit longer. But you are correct in that, like, that's actually how the thorax for Beatrice got made. I'm going to give you a hint. Remember, I sew a lot. Because here's the thing, you can pop a wire through the spool, then just bend it into place. So all of a sudden you've got a layer of thickness there that you can then just wrap the fabric right over. That's actually how the torso of this one got made. Here, and, sorry, I was very much very excited for the fact that I actually got to not throw it out. So yeah.
Oh, also we will be having a Q&A after this talk. So if you have questions, get them ready.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to see if we can tune into people online. So if you have a comment on there, too, we will try and answer it.
But yeah, so as you can see here, so Beatrice's head, so this whole thing here, there's a spool underneath. So the spool was put on and then fabric was popped over top so that what I could do is then I could sew or wrap other fabric to get the general shape. Then one thing, clay does not like to stick to the fabric. However, clay is perfectly fine sticking to glue. So what you do is you literally just paint over the fabric. Any place you're gonna have some kind of clay, paint over the fabric with a little bit of glue. Let it fully dry. You do not want these to rot from the inside. So I mean it, let them dry. But then you can build up as much clay as you'd like. Just keep in mind that it will, it's gonna be heavier than anything else you're gonna work with. So like this one, the legs are much more top heavy. Thankfully they're made to sit, but it's not, you know, it's just something to keep in mind is like, that's gonna be a material that's going to be denser. Most of the other ones though, because they're fabric, ridiculously light. So especially if you're trying to like, if you're the kind of person who has to move your sculptures around, but or if you want to go big, but you also still want to be able to move your sculpture around, this is a pretty easy way to do it. You just build the form up using the wires, spools, anything that cannot be recycled. You can use pill bottles, as you said. You can use, heck, like, you know those little weird bottles that like Mucinex, the liquid comes in, and they're really cool? Well, cool, you can just pop a hole in it with an awl, thread the thing through it, and great, you've got a torso. So that's kind of the thing with a lot of these, is sort of you approximate the general shapes you want, then use the fabric to wrap over it, then you just cover up the parts of the fabric that you don't necessarily want people to see, because I didn't need to have people see, like, ridiculously old bra. That part is like an old sock that the entire thing had just shredded. So just slid that on over her. That's part of an old headband. So that gives you kind of an idea of how these sort of take shape. A lot of trash work, yeah, we're gonna go to like sort of final thoughts in some ways. It's like a lot of trash work is about kind of figuring out what you have. You have a plan, you have an idea, have new materials. How can you make that do, you know, work for them? However, sometimes the materials are going to dictate what you can do. So with these specifically, these are coat hanger wire because I had a ton of them. Coat hanger wire is great. It's cheap, it's plentiful, it's frigging everywhere. Downside, you can only bend it a certain number of times before it can snap in half. So keep that in mind with Beatrice's legs. That's part of the reason they're reinforced with so much fabric. It's to make sure that I can bend Beatrice to a certain extent, but I'm not gonna have to worry about her snapping. But, you know, with something like this, that's part of the reason that these little arms in here are actually pivoted onto. They're spools, one stacked on top of each other in here. And the reason for that is so there's a little bit of flex, but also so the wire isn't being bent into a particular position. So if I ever need to move the arms, it's not gonna crack. So yeah, you are going to be limited to the materials that you have. But the cool thing is, again, if it is already trash, you can't mess it up any more than it already is already. A lot of people are just gonna look at these materials and just go, sod it, I don't have time to clean this up. This stuff is garbage. We don't need this anymore. But you can look at it and go, well, I'll just add a little glue. What's the harm? Why not? The other thing is, climate change is terrifying on an instinctual and existential level. This is, at least for me, one of the better ways I've found with coping with it. Because a lot of the time, a lot of the stuff that like people need to do to handle it is on a larger level. So having some kind of things you can incorporate into your practice as an artist to, you know, deal with that sort of existential terror is really helpful. You know, it makes you feel like, okay, I might not be doing something that's gonna like save the bloody world, but at least I'm reducing the amount of waste I'm putting into the landfill. You also might notice that you sort of change your habits over time. Something I noticed when I started more incorporating it is I started realizing just how much packeted tea I drank. That is part of the reason I swapped over to loose leaf, was because I was having this sort of like, I'd be sitting there looking at this absolute giant plastic bag of tea bags, and my roommate, bless him, would be just like, dude, you don't need that many. I'm like, but I can't throw them out. It's good foil. And he'd just be sitting there looking at me like, Why are you okay? Do you need to talk about this? I'm like, I can't throw out of this much foil. I can't do it. So that's, in some ways for me, a lot of the composting I do, a lot of like the swapping over to using, not like making sure to use reusables and the rest of it, is simply because I have enough materials. I don't need more. I'm trying to kind of keep everything down to a dull roar. So you might notice that. That is kind of fun though, because sometimes it means you'll have so much of a particular substance that you're like, you know what? I've got like 60 billion pill bottles. I wonder if I can make tentacles out of them. You know, like that's the thing, is if you have a lot of a particular material, just go nuts with it. You've literally got tons of garbage. Just build the octopus of your dreams. Are we saying, okay, I will admit, I just really want to make a pill bottle octopus at this point. Let's be fair.
I'm surprised it hasn't happened already.
I mean, look, mostly lack of time, and I'm working on the giant robot that's like at the violin. But yeah, this also is the other thing where if you already do more what's considered traditional art, figuring out ways to use the materials that are just natural waste products of those things is a great way to kind of feel like you're getting your money's worth. Like, something that I really love to do is, I love brush pens. They are great. They have a beautiful swish flick. They're wonderful. At a certain point, the brush pen will go the way of the dodo and die. The cool thing is, they are, you pop everything out of the pen, you have a perfect arm. All you gotta do is have this long tube, you just slide, you know, the wire through it, boom. That meant you didn't have to throw out the pen. There you go. Other things like that, if you've got, let's say, like the paper towels that I mentioned before, any sort of other materials like that, just see if you can incorporate them in practice, because the worst that happens, again, is that you've made some garbage that you had to throw out, but you were gonna do that anyway. So yeah, I think that's pretty much it. Make sure this is good. Yes, cool, I was finished with the slideshow.
Are you ready to try the Q&A?
Yeah, I am gonna drink some water first, though.
Questions from our audience? Okay.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can.
Wonderful, thank you for all that. My question is, what kind of tools do you keep in your studio for doing your sculptures and working with this? Like pliers, hammers, what kind of tools do you use?
So my two favorites that I really love is pretty much just a pair of needle nose pliers, because you can really get in there and turn. And hilariously enough, my legs, basically, here's the thing, trying to clamp something when it's shaped like this doesn't work. If you loop your leg over it and you're bending, lot easier. You can also get a friend to help if it's going to be something a bit more complex. But yeah, best thing to do is just like a good pair of pliers. Oh, didn't think of this, wire snips. I have a pair of industrial wire snips that I use, because you can use regular scissors to cut the type of wire hangers. However, those scissors will hate you. And it's also, there's a very good chance it will ping and go across your room and hit the wall, and then your roommate's like, why is there a scar on the wall? And then you have to look really shifty. I'm sorry, Will. So yeah, that is the definitely something I would recommend, is like good pair of needle nose pliers and something that can cut through heavy materials if necessary. And, you know, the usual, please wear eyewear.
And like fabric scissors, that kind of thing?
So fabric scissors I usually don't use on these guys, because those are usually come when I'm doing large pieces of fabric. With these ones, I'm not really having to be as precise. So I actually use a pair of old Crayola kids scissors for the most part, because they don't have sharp tips. So when I'm dealing with these, I'll usually have a mess on my floor. I don't have to worry about putting my hand in there and being like, So yeah, they're fairly good. I will use larger scissors for like these ones, just because I'm trying to get a nice straight cut when I'm sewing the tubes. But yeah, so fabric scissors are mostly really, really good if you're working with like large amounts of fabric. So yeah.
Thank you. Do you have a question? Okay, any other?
Do you have a question?
Sure. We got time.
Yeah. You sort of briefly touched on preparing materials, like you were saying, you know, if you find it on the street or whatever, make sure to clean it so you don't get parasites or something. Just curious, like, what do you do anything else, like with scrap fabric? Do you do any kind of particular kind of washing, or when you get the bottle caps, are you doing anything to make sure there's no residue on them? Like, how clean is the trash?
So most of what I usually recommend is you don't want any food residue, because you don't want to attract pests, and you also probably want to make sure there's nothing that if you tried to glue to it, it would fall off. Because a dirty thing, it's just gonna glue to the dirt and then fall off. So usually with like these guys, and also with, you know, bottle caps and the rest of it, I take those laundry bags you usually see for like bras and delicates, you dump all of them in there and you throw them in the washer. It works fine. You throw it on a delicate cycle and you're usually all right. Just don't put it through your dryer, because it will scratch the hell out of it. But yeah, you can usually do that. Then I have an old window screen and I have a porch area, so I usually just pop everything on like a tray under the window screen with like a rock on it, and I can just let it dry, you know, in the sun. Also, that's the thing, UV radiation is awesome. So if you can let things air dry in nice sunny locations, that's also gonna help kill anything off too. Yeah, so that's the thing with a lot of those, is I'll usually keep like a little handkerchief in my pocket so I can just put things in it if I find it on the street. And the nice thing is with a handkerchief, I can just pull the whole thing out and I haven't had to really like keep touching it. But yeah, I do recommend if you see anything that possibly, like, you know, I'm not recommending anybody use apple cores or stuff like that. That goes in the compost. Do not use it in your work. I'm sorry. We do not want termites or anything else to come in with you. Same thing also with stuff you find if you're like, if you want to find the shelves, a lot of those I found on like bulk trash. A lot of those I'll usually just take, put in the garage, wipe down with, I usually use a mixture of like rubbing alcohol or, hilarious enough, rot gut vodka. It is amazing. It is basically flammable and it will kill everything. So it is great for that kind of thing. Just give it a good wipe down, again, sun it if you can, and usually after that it's fine. Oh yeah, what's up?
Oh, you have a question?
The yellow leg, those one, what you do, the wrapping, and then you stitch?
So most of them I do that technique. With Beatrice, I tried something a little different in that each of these legs was sewn on my sewing machine, and I basically, you know, sewed it inside out, then took a hook that I made out of a piece of wire, pulled it through, and then I basically shimmied it on like a sock. Then she was sewn. Yeah, basically. Then they were sewn into place. The reason was, is I was trying to avoid having any stitch lines because I thought that would bulk up the leg. But the downside of this is, unfortunately, I nearly ripped a bunch of them because each of the legs was a different size. So that is another thing to keep in mind with a lot of this. Everything you make is going to be a very unique thing, which is both great and a problem if you're trying to make 8 legs. So yeah, like with Meriwether, this one, yeah, I basically wrapped the different pieces into place and then just gently whip stitched them. This is also where that needle nose pliers come in real handy. Trying to go through this material that many layers is going to be murder on your hands. It's better off just grabbing it with the pliers and pulling away from you, because it's just gonna be more comfortable. Like, you're not having to sit there and try and shove it through. You can also use a penny thimble. I love these. They basically look like a little leather piece and they have a flat panel. I usually put them on there because I can use it to shove on one side while I'm pulling with the other. You may also want to look into upholstery needles. They're usually curved. They look kind of like a little half moon. Mm-hmm. And they're meant for people doing upholstery because you can't go through upholstery. They're usually padded, so they kind of meant to go in and then around and then over. You'll actually see them used in surgery, which is pretty fun. I guess it's surgery.
Do we have any online questions?
Oh gosh, dang it, my mic fell over. Yeah.
Okay. So this is where I give you the spiel of the other thing.
Yay!
We should give you the microphone.
Oh, I'm working on it right now, actually.
What was the question? What is the largest piece that Kat has ever made?
Okay, so I am actually currently working on it. So to give some context, part of the reason for these pieces being somewhat smaller is I used to live in a pizza slice of an apartment, and I only had so much storage, so I kind of went tiny. When I moved into my current house, my roommate was like, oh, you can have the entire fourth floor area as a place to work, to which I just basically was like, and Will was like, why am I letting you into my house? But yeah, so the piece, it's literally the size of my torso. It is a giant robot holding a actual violin that I found in the garbage.
It is a life-size robot. I've seen this picture.
Yeah, it's and what I did was I took cardboard boxes that were left over from getting a new vacuum cleaner, so the little ones, kind of hot glued them into place. This is where hot glue comes in handy because you need to stick fast. You're not needing to be strong. You need to be faster. Kind of got the general shape I wanted, and then started to slowly cover the shape in strips of cereal boxes and a huge amount of just cardboard that I had left over from a friend who used to work at a print shop. And she just saved me the offcuts because she knows that I am a raccoon and will sit upon my tiny hoard of garbage. Okay, maybe large hoard of garbage, let's be fair. But yeah, that thing, it's in the process. I still have to work on the arms, like I've got part of it together, but there will be photos actually on any of my websites. If you just search my name, KS Brenowitz, you'll come with all my websites and you'll be able to see this absolute monstrosity made out of cardboard. It's great.
Do you have any shows coming up or places where we can see your art?
Oh, yeah, actually. I'm currently in a show run by the Wheaton Art Parade, which is actually at Wheaton Mall right in Maryland, so it's like right across from the metro. The start of the show is today, but the opening for it is actually on the 18th, so if you want to come and like listen to some live jazz and see a bunch of artwork. The idea of that one is, hilariously enough, it's the opposite scale to the giant robot. Where it's actually, everything is supposed to be 20 inches or smaller. So, yeah, that's going to be my last show. Yep.
This is also where I give the spiel for other stuff that you can come and see at the labs. As you may have noticed, if you're here in person, we have some sewing machines off to the side here because we teach sewing classes. So sewing classes are upcoming. We have sewing reservations that you can do almost every day here that we're open, which would be Tuesday through Saturdays. And we also have an upcoming class about how to measure yourself for clothes, so you can see more info for that at labs.dclibrary.org/labs@dcpl. Labs is plural, like many laboratories, labs. We also, I know we have some younger viewers, and you may actually be a little young to come into the labs right now, but we do have a children's floor. And I think Kat has been putting together some origami. Can you still do the origami kits?
Oh, yeah. So hilariously enough, I actually am one of the children's LAs, so I'm usually on the second floor. But we're actually doing a bunch of, like, we have repurposed origami kits that are made out of different, like, books that have just died.
So you can make trash origami.
Yeah. And we're also going to be hopefully doing some stuff in, like, art and movement and doing collage. So just keep an eye on stuff coming out from there if you're younger and you're wanting to do stuff like that. Because why the frick not? It's fun. And also, seriously, just if you want to make stuff, just do it. This is a great way to make cheap materials, you know?
Yeah. Also, if you are from a smaller space, we actually want people to come in and use the labs to make things. We have some people that come in here to, say, do framing of their art. We've had people come in to cut out large items that they're going to sew together, and we also have we've had some people come in here and use this space to do sculpture because they probably also live in a pizza slice sized apartment. And we have lockers on the far wall here, so if you are a if you're coming in to use the labs and you've taken our safety orientation, You can use these lockers for up to 7 days. So you can come in with your stuff and keep it in the locker so you don't have to haul it back and forth. So we're doing everything we can to encourage people to make things here in this space.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do we have any other questions?
Any idea if I want to make like for our backyards, for outside?
Oh, yeah. So if you're working outside, you got to keep in mind the fact that like the weather is a jerk.
Right.
So I'd probably not recommend working in fabric for that reason, because it'll rot, you'll end up with mold.
Right.
But if you're working with natural materials, actually, oh, what was his name? I think he was Andy Goldsworthy, I think, is a good example of that, because he would use all natural materials and do these sort of patterns using like stones and like different, like, I'm sorry, my brain is going, there we go, leaves. Wow, that just left my brain for a second. But yeah, like leaves, different stuff like that. He would even use ice and actually like freeze things overnight to create shapes and things like that. And he would photograph them. Those are great because it means you're not adding trash to the environment. But also, if you find like a giant log that is just sitting there by the side of the road, and if you can get it home, go for it. Like, I am very much, like, I have a bike that I usually have a trailer, and I have found, honestly, if people are throwing out something, it's usually okay to go grab stuff. Although I will say, if somebody comes out and starts yelling at you, just leave. You can always come back later if it's a problem, but seriously, it's never really worth getting into an argument if you're trying to take somebody's trash. They get persnickety.
Okay. You heard it here first. Don't steal your neighbor's logs.
Yeah, don't steal your neighbor's logs. If you can ask, if you know the person, it's great, because it's also a good way to know your neighbors. If you're like, hey, I would be very happy taking that giant stump off your property. Why? Yeah. I need it to make an octopus.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to have a great conversation at that point.
All right. I think that'll be it. So ta-da! Thank you to our real-life attendees and also to our Discord people and other online people that are tuning in.
Bye, Internet!
Yes. Bye, Internet. Thank you all.